Welcome to the Mental Health for Us, Unite for Change Forum, California. At this time, we welcome our MC, Dr. Steven Siegel.
Welcome to the Mental Health for Us, Unite for Change Forum, California. I'm Steve Siegel, professor and chair of the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at USC. On behalf of Mental Health for Us Coalition, thank you for joining us today. For students in the audience, welcome back to campus. We're glad you all chose to spend your evening with us. Prior to joining USC in 2016, I focused on the care of people with severe and persistent mental illness, both as a clinician and researcher. I now have the privilege of leading mental health services for USC students, as well as patients of the Keck Medicine Health System and those at LAC-USC Hospital. As such, I'm thrilled to be part of this historic event where we will address the barriers to appropriate mental health care for our community. Tonight, we have a full program highlighting the voices of Californians, the work of advocates, and ideas for civic engagement that can help transform our country's approach to mental health and addiction care. First, I'd like to thank our event partner, the Institute for Addiction Science, and our champion sponsors, including the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, Kaiser Permanente, the Kennedy Forum, and the National Council for Behavioral Health. Additionally, our host committee, listed in your program, was helpful in creating this program, and we're grateful for their support. A few logistic notes before we get started. We encourage you to join the conversation on social media. Use hashtag MentalHealthForUs to share your thoughts and photos. We request that you avoid flash photography so as not to distract the speakers. And if you haven't done so, please sign our statement of support. We're working to show policymakers that there's a huge block of voters who care about mental health and addiction. Simply text BRAIN 444-999 to receive a link to our website, as listed on the side. This event is being streamed live on Mental Health for Us Facebook page. So without further ado, I'd like to invite Robert Storr, Executive Director of U.S. Vets Bob Hope Patriotic Hall, and Lisa Foster, a Navy veteran who heads up case management at Women Vets On Point, to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. We live in a country where we can all make a difference with our votes. Let's take a minute to reflect on that by uniting our voices in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Good evening, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. I'm the executive director of U.S. Vets, which is one of the largest nonprofits that take care of our homeless veterans across the country. What many people don't know is just down the street in Bob Hope Patriotic Hall, we're also pioneering prevention and early intervention, an opportunity to stem the tide of homelessness and the loss due to suicide of the veterans that are returning home. We have two amazing programs operating on community college campuses, and one specifically for women veterans on point. Here, as an example of one of the stars of our programs, is our Navy veteran, Lisa Foster, to lead you in the pledge.
Thank you, Robert. Please face the flag. You guys are all standing already. It's perfect. Place your right hand over your heart. If you're a veteran or active duty, you may render a salute. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you both. I'd like to now introduce former Congressman Patrick Kennedy, Mental Health for Us co-chair and founder of the Kennedy Forum. Congressman Kennedy was lead sponsor of the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act of 2008 and served on the President's Commission on Combating Drug and Addiction and the Opiate Crisis. He is co-author with Stephen Fried of A Common Struggle, A Personal Journey Through the Past and Future of Mental Illness and Addiction. Joining Congressman Kennedy is Dr. John Sherrin, Director of the Los Angeles County Department of Mental Health. Welcome, Congressman Kennedy and Dr. Sherrin.
Thank you very much, Dr. Siegel, and all of those who've made today possible, especially our great sponsors, Kaiser Permanente. We want to thank National Council Behavioral Health, American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. You would think with the raging suicide epidemic, with the unprecedented overdose epidemic, and all of those in this country who are suffering from mental illnesses, all of those here in this city of Los Angeles who are living on the streets because of inadequate care for their illness, you would think that this would be a bigger issue in the 2020 campaign. But that is the state of our current country right now. I believe, as someone who lives in long-term recovery, which is for me, means that I haven't had to drink or drug to self-medicate since February 22nd, 2011. And that's a and it took me a better part of my life before I was able to get recovery. So never count anyone out. Today, I have a life beyond my wildest dreams. I left Congress, didn't think I had any future because I was no longer an elected official. I had nowhere to go, nowhere to be, no one to answer my phone calls. And over the course of the next 9 years, I've gotten married, had 5 kids, started the Kennedy Forum, been appointed by the president to serve on his opioid commission, and have the distinct honor of hanging out with people like Dr. John Sherrin, who, like Dr. Siegel, is one of those very few people who are actually delivering medical care that addresses mental illness in this country. And that's another story that is systemic to the challenges we're trying to address with our agenda, the 2020 campaign, because we have this crisis because our country never had the political will to put our resources and our support behind building a mental health system that adequately addressed the mental health needs of our people as a nation. So today, when we have very few psychiatrists like Dr. Siegel and Dr. Sherrin, very few psychologists, social workers, paraprofessionals, we are barely scratching the surface of addressing the needs of those Americans who need help. And the only way to change that is to get activated. And that's going to require us to be political participants in our own democracy. And that doesn't mean that we have to belong to any particular party to do that. It just means that we have to participate wherever our political affiliations take us. I'm honored to be the co-chair of this organization, but my Republican co-chair, Gordon Smith from Oregon, former Republican senator, is my Republican co-chair. And tragically, Gordon Smith lost his son to suicide, Garrett Lee Smith. But he turned his attention towards addressing the needs of other families who had the same challenges that he had as a parent, and his son Garrett had as someone who was a child dealing with mental illness. After Garrett died of suicide, Gordon Smith ushered through the United States Congress the most sweeping suicide prevention program that we have as a nation. And so it always should be instructive that the pain that so many people have gone through can be a force for good. And that is the case for me when I'm in my recovery rooms. It is my peers that are the most helpful to not only myself, but all of those who are struggling with getting recovery. We are our own answer to this challenge. Yes, we need to do legislation. Yes, we need to do money. But we also need to keep in mind it's not hopeless if we can turn to one another and lend each other the simple dignity of the respect of saying hello and what can I do to be of any assistance to help you with your problems. So I am grateful for you all being here tonight and the participants that are going to be presenting tonight. I'd now like to turn this over to Dr. Sharon, who I was with the other night in Paramount Studios watching the full film, the clip of which you are about to see, but I'll let John briefly introduce that and then we'll come back after the clip to discuss what you watch.
Thank you, Patrick. I want to give it up for this guy. This guy is he's the lead. Patrick is leading this country in terms of advocacy. He has courage that is quite rare. And when I look to him and I spend time with him, he inspires me, and I think he can inspire all of you to come together to push for a new level of activism and advocacy, which is really what this whole event is all about. Patrick mentioned that there's a wonderful film called Bedlam, and we're going to be watching a clip of Bedlam. And what I'll say about Bedlam is that another Kennedy, John F. Kennedy, challenged us with a vision for community-based services to take care of people who were suffering and to prepare for deinstitutionalization. That challenge remains. We're still way, way behind, and together as a collective, we can push for that future. So I ask you to watch this clip. I would ask you to watch the full film when you have the opportunity. And after the clip, Patrick and I will share some thoughts.
A lot of people down here suffer from either drug addiction or mental health issues, and that's why they're down here. It's sad. It's really sad. You know, I suffer from it, and these people suffer from it, and there ain't no help nowhere. We just keep going around in circles, and we get nothing. It's just sad.
People want to hear. It's not something they want to talk about.
I'm calling from LAC USC. I was calling because we have a patient here. She's here in our psych ER.
The state of mental illness in this country is beyond the trite notion of crisis. It's at a point of comedic absurdity. The number of people that we've just completely given up on is just staggering.
A lot of people down here suffer from mental health issues, and that's why they're down here.
You know, I suffer from it, and these people suffer from it, and there ain't no help nowhere. It's just sad.
We have historically not fought for people with mental illness. And people are rising up and saying, we are sick and tired of our families being thrown away.
No justice! No peace!
As long as doctors tolerate these working conditions and the outside world won't know what's going on, then nothing will ever get better. The definition of insanity is repeating the same thing over and over and expecting different results. The way we treat mentally ill in this country is insane.
I'm afraid that's the system.
So, Milliman Corporation is a leading analytics firm that is hired by this nation's largest health insurers and businesses to help them do very sophisticated market analytics. Did I use enough big words there? I mean, the Milliman Company is the one that the most conservative crowd goes to for their data. And what did they just come up with? They analyzed 46 million payers' claims data across the country and across the insurance industry, every single insurer. In this data, they showed, this is California data, as you can see, this would be intolerable. If you were going for health care and you found that to get diabetes care, you had to go for outpatient, you got to get it 6 times more likely to be out of network, which you'd have to pay more money in terms of copays and deductibles, people would be outraged. Primary care providers were paid 24% more than similar providers in mental health and addiction, and Californians had to go out of network for inpatient care 8 times more than they did for any other types of care. This is a reflection of the fact that we don't pay for mental health and addiction care the same as we do other medical and surgical issues. When we wrote the Mental Health Parity and Addiction Equity Act, it said inpatient in-network, outpatient in-network, inpatient out-of-network, outpatient out-of-network, pharmacy and ER benefits. They all had to be on par, hence the word parity, with medical and surgical care. Of course, even though that was a law that was passed by the federal government, Congress, signed into law by President Bush, we never saw that really implemented. I will say that the big challenge in that, and the reason we're here tonight, is that we haven't really developed the advocacy to implement it. And basically, that advocacy needs to take the form of, are you pressing your insurance commissioners? Are you pressing your state legislators? And you're pressing your attorneys general to enforce the laws. And that, unfortunately, doesn't happen because we in the mental health addiction world are not as organized, to say the least, that in a way that we need to be. And so laws implementing these and regulations implementing parity are very few and far between. And unbelievably, even during the peak of the opioid crisis, insurance companies allocated less money than they had before for the treatment of people with addiction. And if you can believe it, only one out of every $100, that in fact for all healthcare, is spent on substance use treatment, even though any physician can tell you practically every other medical condition is impacted by people's mental health. And yet, no one in the medical profession is really trained in having an understanding of comorbidities and how much for cardiovascular disease, depression is a factor, and how much in diabetes, both alcoholism and other mental illnesses are a factor. And so these stats are just a reflection of the fact that as a nation, we've not demanded our medical civil rights. Because what was civil rights all about? Civil rights was not to be treated separately and unequally. And while we passed the Civil Rights Act of 64, voting rights of 65, and we haven't eradicated racism, we have said that it's illegal to treat people who are minorities in a separate and unequal manner. And which means that if you are treated separately and unequally, you have a right to redress. That's called discrimination. And there are laws that say that's wrong. We have that law in this parody, but we don't enforce it. What did the NAACP? What did other organizations, La Raza and all of them, do? They organized. They lodged lawsuits. They picked jurisdictions. And then they got great justices like Thurgood Marshall, who back in the day was one of the champions for the implementation of the Civil Rights Act. So it's not enough to get a law in the books. We need to push that law into enforcement. And I think what we've seen here in California, and Dr. Sharon can answer this, because he picks up the public tab. In other words, he represents the taxpayers. So Dr. Sharon, what happens when all of the big insurers don't pay or, you know, put higher thresholds for accessing reimbursement for mental health and addiction care? Where do those patients go?
They come to the Department of Mental Health. And we see that actually pretty regularly, particularly for people that require longer-term care, because longer-term care is very expensive. And, you know, when insurers drop people specifically because they have illnesses that require ongoing services, it actually breaks the system because we don't have enough resources to manage people. And I think it, you know, part of the reason why Patrick's always so jacked up and it took him so long to sit is because this guy is like the most junior congressman in our nation passed a parity law. And here we are. Here we still are. But, and I think that the thing that is not understood and respected is that these are chronic conditions of different severity, but they're chronic conditions. And chronic conditions require relentless care, relentless services. And until we kind of build that into our approach to serious mental illness, to addiction, we're never going to solve the crises that we have. Of course, we have to invest heavily in prevention. We have to prevent and mitigate trauma in a big way, particularly in our younger populations. But we also have to recognize, identify it early, go after it early, stem the tide and the severity that will develop over time, and stay on it. Stay on it like you would for someone that has chronic kidney disease, that may be dialysis dependent. But we don't do that. And these numbers say it all. And our approach in our clinics say it all. And a big, big challenge that we face all day long, and Steve, I'm sure, would echo my point, we have to create systems that are engaging and that are welcoming, that are non-judgmental. That's a big, big challenge. We don't have systems that are inviting and that are comfortable. And we have to, that requires cultural change. So we in the Department of Mental Health, which is a large bureaucratic system with gulagish buildings, are trying to move in that direction. Because at the end of the day, it's all about heart. It's all about connecting as people and leveraging humanity to help people heal and sticking with it in a relentless way. I think we're largely over time, sir.
So I just want to say, one of the challenges is this, seeing the return on investment. And we are very short-sighted. We still think we can cure everything. What we don't have is a care system. We have a cure system, not a care system. And one of our sponsors tonight, Kaiser, by happenstance happens to have one of the longest memberships. When you're a member, they have the record of all these insurers in terms of carrying someone over the longest period of their lifetime. So they have an interest in keeping you well, because it's financially in their interest to practice the kind of prevention that is going to be necessary to reduce, frankly, their other medical costs. So one of the things we need to advocate for all insurers is that we have a new reimbursement model that emphasizes long-term investments that will be realized not in a quarterly report that an insurance company has to produce, but in kind of a lifetime that can be really realized through what they call risk contracting over longer and longer periods. So we see innovation in the way healthcare is incentivized. That's going to mark a major change, because if this isn't financially viable for the payers, and we're going to continue to see them erect barriers to who they treat if they only see expenditures and not a return on this, and if they don't invest in the kind of prevention that really can make a difference. So we have all of this outlined, not only at Mental Health for Us, but at the Kennedy Forum. And again, I want to thank all of our sponsors for making not only this forum possible, but for others that we are doing around the country. We've left Iowa, where we did Mental Health for Us. We've just been in New Hampshire 2 weeks ago, and we're going to be moving on to other states and also in the general election. So I want you to know, your being here tonight is just part of a process. And what we need to do is not only have it lead up to the 2020 election, but we need to have it continue after the election so that we can continue to push this agenda with a new Congress. And that's all I'll say about anything else. Thank you very much.
You. Please join me in thanking Mr. Kennedy and Dr. Sharon. So I hope you'll all excuse that we went a bit over on that segment. I think we would all agree that was totally worth it. So as Mr. Kennedy and Dr. Sharon mentioned, California has its fair share of challenges. But we also have some incredible work happening in our state. And up next, we have an esteemed panel of policy experts to discuss some of the issues and solutions that can benefit those living with mental health and substance use challenges. Our moderator, Kate Snow, will now introduce the panel.
Hi, everybody. How you guys doing? That's it. Come on, how you doing? My name's Kate Snow. I work for NBC News. Some of you may have seen me do that. I'm an anchor of nightly news on Sunday, and then I'm a correspondent during the week, and I do a lot of reporting around mental health. So that's why I'm sitting here. Hello. Let me introduce our panel. To my right is Dr. Ellen Sachs, and you may recognize her here on campus. Yeah. She is a founder and faculty director of the Sachs Institute for Mental Health Law, Policy, and Ethics, which she created 10 years ago with funding from a MacArthur Fellowship. That's the genius one. She's also the Orrin B. Evans Distinguished Professor of Law, Professor of Psychology and Psychiatry, and the Behavioral Sciences at the USC Gould School of Law. She also, I don't know how you do all this, she also teaches at the Keck School of Medicine here at USC. Also San Diego, right? I mean, she's all over the place. She writes extensively in the area of law and mental health. Her memoir is called The Center Cannot Hold, My Journey Through Madness, and it describes her own struggles with schizophrenia and her managing to craft a good life, a great life for herself in the face of that prognosis. Next up, Dr. Norm Ornstein is one of the best-known scholars of political science, elections, Congress. He is the guy that people like me call and beg to run to a studio to do an interview for us when we need context. He's a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. He's a co-host of AEI's Election Watch series, which is, and also a contributing editor and columnist for National Journal and for The Atlantic, a BBC News election analyst. It goes on and on. He's also chairman of the Campaign Legal Center. He also has a really personal connection that, frankly, I did not know until we talked on the phone this week. And I'll let him tell his story of his connection to mental health. And then on the end, Dr. Ricky Blumenthal, who you may recognize from campus too, Associate Dean for Social Justice, a professor in the Department of Preventative Medicine at the Keck School of Medicine here at USC. For decades now, he's been doing research on health promotion among people who have substance use disorders, specifically injection drug users. He is widely published, has led many studies funded by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the National Institute on Drug Abuse, among many other national bodies who fund his work. He also has a long history of work and research on HIV and AIDS prevention. It's an esteemed panel. Thank you, guys. Thank you all for being here. So our task is to talk a little bit about, and there's so much we could talk about, but we talked on the phone this week and we thought the really pressing issue right now is access to mental health care. You heard Patrick talk about it. So I'd like to take just a couple of minutes, if I can ask you. I'll start with you, Ellen, and work our way down. And just tell me why you think it is a huge issue and what the largest barriers to access are right now. And maybe you can talk a little bit about your work, but I promise I'll get to each of your
Okay, it's a really good and important question. I mean, it seems to me the two biggies in this arena are right and access to treatment and right to refuse treatment, and they sometimes are in tension. And we need to think about ways to accommodate both of them. I have done some medical research with Dr. Steve Martyr from UCLA. We can forgive him for that. And, on high-functioning people with schizophrenia, and we have two MDs, two JDs, a PhD candidate, a full-time teacher, and so on. And I asked them what percentage of patients with mental health disorders or schizophrenia is high-functioning in our sense. He said, I don't know, Ellen, the real question is how many could be if we devoted proper resources. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly right, and I think we owe it to ourselves, to our families, and to our communities to give people the resources to lead good and happy and productive lives. Barriers. Money, just costs a lot of money, stigma, people not wanting to come forward and identifying as mentally ill, refusing treatment. I think sometimes it's okay to refuse treatment if you have capacity to do that, but if you don't, then that's problematic. Yeah. So those are my thoughts.
Great, thanks. Thank you.
So let me give a couple of minutes of the reason I'm in this, because I'm not naturally somebody focused on mental health policy. But 5 years ago on January 3rd, I lost my 34-year-old son, Matthew, after a 10-year struggle with serious mental illness. Like so many with these conditions, he was a brilliant young man. He was a national debate champion in high school, went to Princeton, came out here to Hollywood, was having some success when he had a psychotic break at 24. And we went through 10 years. He had 10 years of indescribable pain. His family, including his brother, Danny, who's here in the audience, my wife and everybody else, went through the pain as well because we have a completely broken system. And for Matthew, one of the challenges which hits so many people with serious brain diseases is he had as a part of his brain disease something called anosognosia, a tongue twister of a word that means that he had no insight into his illness. He did not believe he was ill. And if you're over 18 and face that challenge, the lack of access that occurs more generally becomes an even bigger hurdle. And many times, for example, we were not able to get anybody to talk to him or to talk to us because HIPAA is used as a shield. Now, fortunately for us, our son didn't have many encounters with the criminal justice system, although so many do. We know that the largest facilities for people with serious mental illness are the LA County Jail, the Cook County Jail, and Rikers Island. And Rikers Island is going to be closed before long. And the fact that we don't have the beds anymore, that we frankly don't have psychiatrists who have much interest in treating people with serious mental illness. My wife sometimes says that it's like the fire department. If you call and said, my cat's up a tree, we'll be right there. If you said, my house is on fire, it will be, can you bring it by next Tuesday? Be there right at 11, and we'll see what we can do. And if you don't have people who can come right on time and then stay for 45 minutes, leave and pay, there isn't a lot of interest and there isn't a lot of knowledge with people in the field of psychiatry in many cases about the law, about the standards that are set, where getting treatment for somebody, especially with no insight, requires and you'd be in imminent danger to yourself or others, which in many places, including Maryland, where my son lived for much of the time, means you either have to have a gun to your own head or a knife to somebody else's throat. And we have a system where there is nobody who wants to do much about it. I would add one other thing, Kate. My son, like so many others with serious mental illness, smoked heavily. There is something about the nicotine that can create some soothing capacity. And in this society now, if you have a serious mental illness, the stigma is enormous. If you smoke, it is a double stigma, and it means that you can get hounded in a lot of ways in a lot of places. And we haven't found good ways to cope with that either.
There's so much to talk about there. We'll come back to both of you. Dr. Blumenthal, tell us about your work and what you see.
Yeah, sure. For 30 years, I've been doing research among people who inject drugs, mostly heroin and meth use. And substance use disorder, of course, is one of the most prevalent problems we have in our society. And, you know, I'm sorry to pile on to the inadequacies of the system, but I've been listening to people throughout the country and in my own work in California advocate for treatment on demand, and we've never gotten close to that. You know, we have a system of care that's set up to make it almost impossible for people who have authentic problems to actually get the care that they might need. So stigma contributes to that, but, you know, also these systems of care just are not set up to be patient-friendly. And what I would sort of argue is that at the end of the day, when we have some effective treatments, biomedical treatments in particular, we really do need to make them available in a way that people who are suffering through multiple mental health comorbidities, right? So, because of course, if you've been using serious drugs like heroin and meth for a long time, you are gonna have other presentations of mental health problems. We need to sort of make that really ridiculously easy for people to get access to. And we really don't do that in that space. So substance use disorders disproportionately contribute to morbidity and mortality in the United States. And in the 30 years I've been in this space, we've done very little to get to a place where people who need care can get the care that they need.
Yeah. When I report, I go all over the country, and every place I go, I hear families talking about barriers. I mean, not being able to, you know, going into the ER, not being able to get a bed for someone, or living in rural America and having to drive hours to get to a doctor. How do we begin, legally speaking? I mean, you're the law expert. How do we begin to tackle what seem like insurmountable? Maybe it's not a legal
question. Yeah. And a faith question, and our ability to care about and do things to help our family members and loved ones. So I really think, you know, there's a lot more that we could be doing that we don't do because we don't want to spend the money.
We being the legislature?
All of us.
Yeah. All of us.
I mean, not all of us, obviously. Not the people on this stage, of course.
Do you think fundamentally that it's up to taxpayers or you know, you're the political expert. Is it up to Americans to demand that this gets talked about? I mean, I would note, I've been watching all the debates, the Democratic debates so far. No one's been asked about mental health. Tomorrow night, there's another opportunity.
No, that's true. And that's one of the problems, I think, of some of your colleagues who are up there on the debate stage asking questions that they've asked probably 150 questions about Medicare for all and not one about mental health. I mean, there are a whole lot of areas, but that's one of them. I would say certainly resources is a part of it. I got engaged in this issue about 9 months after my son died when some members of Congress came to me because what became the 21st Century Cures Act was foundering in Congress for a variety of reasons, and they asked if I could help. And I wrote a piece in the New York Times about our story, which was very painful, but I was really stunned. I got a flood of letters and emails and calls almost all of them people saying, I've never told anybody this, but. And what I've come to realize is there's scarcely a family in America that has not been touched in some fashion by mental illness, but they don't want to talk about it. That's where the stigma comes in. You know, I look at what's been done in AIDS research, what's been done in breast cancer research, what's been done to mobilize, and these are extraordinarily important things, but there are fewer people who've been touched directly by them than by mental illness. And this community has not mobilized in the same way. Maybe it could, and if it did, I think it would make a difference. But I would make another point as well. It isn't just about spending money. We're now, my family has a foundation that we've set up in my son's memory, Matthew Ornstein Foundation, go to mornstein.org. We're doing a documentary on a judge in Miami-Dade County, Florida, named Steve Lifeman, who has miraculously transformed the way the criminal justice system there deals with people with serious mental illness. And what he's done is to save lives and save money. He's trained 6,700 police officers in crisis intervention team policing. They used to have an average of 25 shootings a year and encounters between police and people with serious mental illness. And anybody who's been in this situation with a family member, you sometimes get a crisis, you think about calling the police, and you don't know if they'll help or if they'll shoot. And they're not trained, they don't know how, you know, you go to somebody, and if you're a police officer, your protocol is, you give an order, and if it's not obeyed, you escalate, which is the worst thing you can do. With this training, they're down to one shooting, I think, in the last 5 years, and they've been able to save a fortune in wrongful death suits. They've closed a jail because they've cut the number of arrests in half, saved $12 million a year. And with a proper system of diversion, wraparound services, people coming through the system, most of them, by the way, because of drug issues, because they're comorbidities, you can actually get people out onto their feet. They're not homeless in front of the stores, and you can save money. And it's just sharing those best practices, but also for politicians, sometimes you have to pay money to get it started, and it comes out of one pocket, and then the savings may go into another. But there are ways in which we can actually improve the system without pouring a huge additional sum of money into it.
I mean, I agree that it's not just money, and I think stigma is really important. Mostly important.
Has the stigma decreased, though? Because as a reporter, I feel like over the past 10 years, I see some change.
Anecdotally, like in my mental health law class, the students apply and write essays. And for the first 9 years, I would say 8 of them self-disclosed as having illness or in their family or friends. And they met as a class, and we went around the room, and only one person self-disclosed. Which is sort of interesting, because law students are all about dignity and liberty and standing up for rights. This past year, we had 10 students, and 8 of them self-disclosed, including one woman who said, I have never before said this out loud outside my family, but I have bipolar illness. Very anecdotal, it's obviously not a study or anything like that, but if it does signal anything, it signals that things are getting better.
You yourself didn't initially disclose your story, right, early on in your career?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
I just say, people, if you have 15 minutes, watch your TED Talk.
Oh, thank you.
Is incredible. Seriously, it's incredible.
I appreciate that. Thanks.
I want to get Ricky back in the conversation. The population that you study, what do you see as solutions? I mean, you're one of the people who've founded needle exchange programs.
Yeah, in Harvard.
Right, way back when.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think the key is, I mean, we have a very uncaring society. So let's just start there.
Uncaring
society. It really is true. I mean, the institutional response to the epidemics, the opiate overdose death crisis right now, I mean, you'd almost never know it if you actually looked at what's going on in many communities. So there's a lot of indifference. So I call it uncaring. I mean, I think there's an alternative, which is a caring society, which means that you have to put people who have severe problems at the center of the systems of care. So right now, we have a system of care that works terrific for me, right? I'm a professor and associate dean in a medical school. I own a home. I'm well-educated. I get care when I need it. The fact of the matter is, that doesn't work if you're homeless and using heroin or homeless and using meth. And we need to build the system from the bottom up. So we need to take our toughest cases, folks with severe mental illness, folks with multiple morbidities, folks who have those conditions and are also poor, and then ask ourselves, well, what would it actually take for a person in this circumstance to get the care that they need? And what that means is that we have to change, right? So we have to be leaning into the problems, leaning into the populations that need the services, and come up with systems that make sense to them. Right now, we have a system that makes a lot of political sense, like even the conversation about money, which always makes me a little bit half-batty. We spend money on all kinds of stuff all the time that really doesn't even matter, right? It's not a money thing. We just gave one of the largest tax cuts in the history of the country. You know, our deficit's off the hook. I mean, the money doesn't matter if it's going to people like me or people who make even more than I do. And whenever it turns, you flip it and you say, hey, there are these folks who really need stuff. We can't really spend money on them. And the truth is, they're in those circumstances because we're not spending money on them, right? There's a relationship between how we distribute, how we distribute our shared goods in the society and the people who don't end up getting care. It's not an accident. It happens on a multitude of issues, including this one.
So, Kate, I just wanted to, I don't mean to be political here. It's getting better in some ways, it's getting worse in others. The National Rifle Association and the president are trying to re-stigmatize serious mental illness to divert attention away from the larger problems with drugs, with guns. And, you know, what President Trump has been talking about is reinstitutionalization, but not in the ways that any of us up here would talk about it, which is to have more beds and have opportunities for people in crisis to actually get somewhere. And, you know, getting back to the notion of people waiting in emergency rooms, at one point, my son was in a hospital. There were, I think, 12 people who were just sitting down in the corridor for a weekend because there were no beds. And others don't even get into that kind of a situation. Reinstitutionalizing in the old fashioned by rounding up people is not what you want to do. And creating this sense that if somebody has a serious mental illness, those are the ones who are participating in mass shootings is a vast distortion of the reality. The vast majority of violence in the country, even that with guns, is not done by people with serious mental illness. There is a small category. Those are the ones who are untreated in this society, and they're a very small category. And if we eliminated all of that, you'd get rid of maybe 4% of those kinds of incidents. So we have to fight back against re-stigmatization along with dealing with the other larger stigma that comes from people being ashamed to talk about it.
Dr. Sachs, you're studying something that you call supported decision making. You mentioned it earlier. Can you tell us, for those of us who don't know what that is, what is it and what are you finding in your research?
Thanks for asking. We're very excited. So the general regime around the country is one of finding someone incompetent and appointing a guardian to make decisions for them. And we're supporting an idea of asking people who in their lives they would like to help them make their own decisions. And we want to study who they pick and why, their satisfaction with the decision-making process, and downstream effects like less hospitalization, more independent living and working. And our first study is in four jurisdictions, four medical schools, USC, UCLA, UCSD, and Dan State SUNY New York. And again, we're studying who they pick and why and what the downstream effects are. Second study is being supported by the Millionaire Tax. We're very grateful, and we're looking at several counties' Department of Mental Health and what they're doing around these issues. And we want to, right now we're doing an innovation year, but we want to study intensively maybe two or three of those jurisdictions. And if this works, it restores more people to being the architects of their own lives. And it feels good to have autonomy, speaking as someone who's had it taken away from her. So the more we can help people exercise choice, I think the better we're going to be. We have to wait and see if it works. We're just at the beginning, but we're excited about it.
Yeah, you haven't really talked about your own past. You were hospitalized.
Oh yeah, I. I thought I said that. Sorry.
Well, maybe you did.
I basically sort of had a normal high school and college, but when I went to graduate school, I broke down, and it started out looking like depression with mild psychotic features, but evolved into a pure psychotic disorder versus a mood disorder. So speaking as only one person and who has, you know, everyone becomes psychotic in her or his own way. For me, it involved delusions like thoughts that I had killed people, hundreds of thousands of people with my thoughts, or that nuclear explosions were going to go off in my brain. Some hallucinations, a man standing with a raised knife. It was actually a funny story. When I was a junior person at USC, there was a senior woman who had had trouble herself. And she was telling me, I was visiting her in Berkeley, and she was telling me I just could not use this paper. It was a horrible paper, and I wouldn't get tenure. Got published by Yale University Press. But anyway, I slept that night in her condominium, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and at the foot of my bed was a little bicycle with a devil riding it. So you've got a delusion that sort of makes sense of what's going on in your life in some way.
Is yours a success story in terms of access to care? I mean,
I had excellent care. Sometimes people will say that. They'll say, you know, Professor Sad, they'll be in the audience, clinicians, you see your doctor 5 days a week. I can see my patient 15 minutes every 3 months. How are they supposed to do as well as you? And I say, of course they can't. You're right. And I have some survivor guilt, but I wouldn't give it away. I'm going to still stay as well as I can. But that's why I think what Steve Martyr said about resources is so important, because I think so many people could do so much better.
Well, yeah, and Ricky, you talked about clearly the issue is far more grave for people who don't have means, but at the same time, I've been public about being in therapy myself. Everybody I go to in New York is out of my network.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm lucky that I can afford it, but even for people who have good insurance and who, nobody's recording this, right? Who work for NBC News and have, I'm serious, I have like the best insurance, and yet things are really, really expensive. If I can even find someone who will take me in New York City, and they will not take insurance, I'm sure it's the same way in Los Angeles.
Probably.
No provider will actually accept an insurance card. You have to submit it all yourself.
I mean, I think these implementation problems really persist across the whole spectrum of challenges in this area. But there are solutions. I mean, we could imagine, a mental health Marshall Bill for the United States of America, where you sort of say, look, my mom had serious mental illness, right? You know, people in my family, extended family, have serious mental illness issues. So we all benefit from that. And when they're untreated, we're all suffering. So the families suffer along with their family member. So it's probably an investment that would really work for all of us. You know, you'd have people because care would be more widely available, not missing work, right? You would have people less stressed out because they're worried about what's happening with their child. I mean, what Mr. Ornstein's gone through is every parent's nightmare. Yeah. You know, when your child suffers, you're suffering right along with them. So if we had some imagination and we wanted to flip the script and just sort of say, look, this is a problem that we all actually have, and it's something we would all benefit from, but we need a different kind of politics. And we need a politics that's focused on really doing what's in our common good. And I'm sorry to say, as you pointed out, at least one party has sort of moved away from even any discussion of that kind of common good. It really is often about, what's my money? What do I get out of this? And the truth is, if we want to be a society, we actually have to lean into each other. And that means caring about the problems that we all have.
How do we get mental health care out of the criminal justice system? Huge question. I don't know who wants to start, but that seems to be, that intersection of criminal justice and mental health is one of the biggest parts of the problem.
So this is where I think we actually have some great ideas. And it's Judge Leifman in Miami-Dade has done miraculous things. There are some other places that are starting to move in that direction. Actually, even in Detroit, they're starting to pick up on some of what he's been able to do. It's more than just having a mental health court. Most of the mental health courts in the country have judges who don't really know what they're doing. They don't have any real sense of what it means to have a serious mental illness.
It's the training and the background?
It's training and background. Now judges are starting to step up a little bit, but we've seen instances where somebody can be floridly psychotic, come in front of a judge, and appear to be just perfectly fine, And despite a record this thick in front of the judge, it's, I don't see anything wrong here. Or they'll get sent out into an outpatient setting where all they get is somebody coming by once a week and saying, here are your meds. You have to have a wraparound service situation. We have to train people, not just police, by the way. I want to train people in schools when kids act out. You don't bring in a security guard to throw them up against the wall where there are problems. We need to have universities get more sensitive and serious about what they can do when they see kids having issues. And this is where HIPAA comes into play as well, and it's often misused by administrators in hospitals and elsewhere. But, you know, the suicide and serious mental health crisis, we need to get more people who understand how to communicate. One of the things that we're doing is working with a remarkable psychologist named Javier Amador, who wrote a book called I'm Not Sick, I Don't Need Help, about people like my son who have no insight into their illnesses, to find ways to communicate with them. You know, I had a national champion high school debater, and when I tried to talk logic with him, it got nowhere. But you can find ways to listen reflectively and maybe to create a slightly better situation. But it's going to take effort and training in all kinds of people to recognize this. And I would just add that we have to have a conversation amongst ourselves in this community, because when you're talking about people who have no insight into their illness and resist treatment, often saying it's your choice to live on the street and maybe freeze to death on the street, or to get picked up by a cop, or to get beaten. And we need to have a balance where civil liberties matter, but also where you can take care of people who can't take care of themselves because they don't have any insight into the problems that they have.
I mean, I think there are ways to address insight other than forcing care, like just helping people, like doing what Javier suggests and bringing someone along. Lacking insight to me does not suffice to take choice away.
Not you. I don't want to take choice away from everybody, but there are people who my son believed that, and this is another set of issues, by the way, religious ideation. My son believed that God had come and taken his soul and not his body, and that he had to find a way, and he didn't know how, to get back his soul, and that treatment, he wasn't ill, this was something else. We're trying to train religious people who often will have those with serious mental illnesses come to them, and they have no idea how to respond to it. But when you're in that situation, my son would have done anything to avoid getting treatment. And there were times when my wife said, well, you know, maybe we should get him arrested. And there, that does happen. And sometimes it can work.
Yeah.
But just as often, you'll get a cop who doesn't understand, or you'll go in front of a judge who will say, you're a druggie, you're going to go to jail, and without understanding what the sets of issues are. And we need to have massive education here.
So where do we start? Because you're all talking about such huge issues that it almost feels impossible. Where do we begin to make some change, since probably everybody in this room agrees that change needs to happen? Ellen, I'll ask you that.
One way is to have forums like this where people think through the issues and work together to...
If you had an audience with the president, with Congress, if you were at the debate tomorrow night, what would you... No, I'm serious.
Speaking of lack of insight.
What would you ask? What would you say? What would you ask? What would you want them to think about? Our leaders.
I guess the three most important things are access to treatment, support for people who are refusing treatment and understand what they're doing or not incapable, and supported decision making. So putting that regime in place so that we can get more people to be making their own choices.
Either one of you.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of it is putting in the social infrastructure for there to be a range of kind of options for treatment. I mean, one of the things that happens with stigma, both internal and external, And it relates both to regular mental illnesses and then those that are related to substance use disorder, is that we feel like people don't deserve the human dignity that the rest of us have. And so we don't work to create systems of care that actually give people choices. And I think in my, you know, in my space, I like to say everything I've learned about health, I learned at a needle exchange program. Like, it's amazing when you actually give people resources and have a conversation about what's, you know, maybe we're not going to get everywhere that I might want to go, but let's get you somewhere that you want to go. And if we had the resources to do that, whether it's shared living, whether it's, you know, a locked facility, whether it's just counseling on a regular basis, but we've got to build up our social infrastructure to do that, and we're just not creating a pipeline where that's even where that's
and
even
the laws
possible.
That have been passed. You're an expert on Congress. I mean, there's been all kinds of laws passed.
Well, we you know, Patrick of course was a superstar here. Although we know that getting mental health parity in the law doesn't mean that insurance companies are going to follow it to a T, and they don't. At the same time, the 21st Century's Cures Act, which did some very positive things, has been underfunded and largely ignored. We don't have a mobilization at that level. Just for a minute, I'll talk about, so we're doing this film. Ours is called The Definition of Insanity. It's actually a partner with Bedlam. You saw a little
the
bit of that,
that
a brilliant film that Ken
Can I also
Rosen
just say that Rob Reiner is gonna be voicing this?
Rob is doing the narration right. for our film.
So you gotta see it just for that.
It will be on public television in May, in Mental Health Month. But it's not just about seeing a movie. My goal and our goal is to take it around the country and to convene stakeholders, not just people in the mental health community, in the legal community, in the police community, the law enforcement community, in the business community, and elsewhere in the university community, and talk about best practices and see if in local areas they can think about what their needs are and what their resources are and ways in which they can begin to implement some of them. One of the big problems, the other problems we have in this country is there are experiments done in a lot of places. There are things that work and we don't share them very widely, and we need to find better ways of doing that. And that is where you do such great work, Kate, and where some of your colleagues can be helpful as well. And maybe one of them will ask a damn question about mental health policy tomorrow night at the debate.
I'm not going to be there.
If only you were there.
I know that it's been talked about. I mean, I know that I can't say too much, but I know in the prep for the last debate, yeah. There was a lot of preparation of questions that had to do with mental health that just didn't have time for. Yeah. Which is unfortunate. All right, we need to wrap up soon. 16 seconds to go, but I'm going to let you each have one final word. Let's be positive. Let's talk about what gives you hope. What gives you hope right now?
Well, I'll go first. Yeah, so one thing that happened in LA County is that thanks to community mobilization, they decided to not build another jail. And instead, that effort's going to go. So that's a huge win. And that's one thing you could do at a local level.
So I do think I'm starting to see more and more people who are coming out of their shells and families coming out of their shells and talking about the fact that it is in their families. The more that happens, the more we will get a larger conversation, and maybe the more we'll get mobilization that will get politicians to talk about it and think about it in a different way.
I agree. I think people being able to come forward and tell their stories is incredibly important. So coming to see a mental health disorder as a brain disorder does not much reduce stigma, but putting a human face on does. So to the extent that people can come forward and tell their stories without jeopardy to their work or relational life, I think that's a really good thing to
do. We've started to talk about serious mental illness as stage 4 brain disease.
Interesting.
And
yeah.
If we can think about this as a neurological problem, not a mental problem, I mean, I will tell you, we used to have well-meaning people come up to us to talk about our son and say, you just need to kick him in the ass, as if he had the will to be able to stop doing this stuff. It is an organ disease like any other
right.
organ.
No one would say that to someone like with diabetes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or someone with a heart,
right.
heart disease.
You don't say to somebody with cancer, just get off your ass and do something about it. you know, we treat it in a completely different way, and we have to start thinking of this as a brain disease. It's an organ disease.
Dr. Sachs, I did want to ask you one last thing. I know we're over time, but Patrick went over too. By a lot. You created the Sachs Institute for Mental Health Law, Policy, and Ethics here.
Yes.
And every year you look at one thing, right?
Yes.
You really, what is your focus for this academic year so that the people at USC know what you're up to?
So the focus for this year is on immigration, mental health, and asylum. So we're gonna have a symposium in March. You all are welcome. And we'll have speakers from different categories, people who are immigrants themselves, you know, people who have family members who need asylum, lawyers that do these cases. We have psychiatrists who evaluate children at the border, and we're going to really try to have a conversation about these issues. And the topic for next year is going to be early intervention,
okay,
which we're going to partner with Harvard on that. So we're excited.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
Fascinating for me. I appreciate all of you so much. Picture?
Oh.
Standing? Okay. Sorry, quick photo.
This is awkward.
Yeah. Nice. I'm not sure who I'm supposed to introduce next, but I'm just going to say thanks to these folks. There we go. Are you next? Okay, great. I apologize. Yeah. Thanks.
No,
well, good evening, everybody. My name is Adam Leventhal. I am the director of the USC Institute for Addiction Science, and I'm just thrilled that you all are here on this really, really important and timely event. So let me first thank Patrick Kennedy and the Mental Health for Us people. We had the opportunity to co-sponsor this event and hold it here at USC, and when that opportunity came up, we jumped at it. So it's been amazing. I'd like to thank the speakers who have been great, and you've only heard half of them so far. And of course, I want to thank all of you all for spending some time and dedicating it to this important issue. So as I mentioned, I'm the director of the Institute for Addiction Science. So I'm going to talk to you just for a brief second about addiction. So we all hear the term crisis, epidemic, for these key issues. I'm going to use the term pandemic. There's an addiction pandemic happening right now in the United States. And so what's a pandemic? It's basically like a mega epidemic. So if you think about it, we have, of course, the opioid crisis and overdose, but it's not just opioids. People are overdosing on methamphetamines, sedatives, and cocaine and other drugs, and those numbers are increasing, unfortunately. We also, with the legalization and commercialization of marijuana, we're seeing rates of marijuana use going up and people putting themselves at risk for marijuana addiction and marijuana-related problems. And unfortunately, that's something that will likely continue. And then also, we have a youth nicotine vaping epidemic. So more than one out of four high school students in the United States vape nicotine. And we're trying to do some stuff about that here at USC, but you know, this shouldn't be something that's just overlooked. These are young people that are getting introduced to drugs through nicotine, and it's something that we have not expected. So what do we do about it? Well, so we need to think about what are the causes of this addiction pandemic. Maybe is addiction a brain disease? Is addiction a genetically inherited psychological predisposition? Is addiction a social justice issue? Is addiction ineffective or insufficient policies? Well, what's the answer? C, all of the above, right? So this is a massive problem, and then you throw in the mix that most people suffering from addiction are also suffering from another behavioral health disorder. So, you know, I'm a scientist and I'm at awe with all of the politicians and community members and advocates here today. So what can I do and what can me and my colleagues do at the Institute for Addiction Science? Well, we need to unite, just like we're all here to unite for change today. And so what does that mean? Well, in our field is very segmented and people work in silos who are addressing the common issue of addiction. We have sociologists working over here. We have psychologists working in their network. We have the physicians working in a separate hub. And really our collective power is much, much greater if we can work together and share our ideas and come up with multifaceted solutions to address this problem, which has multiple causes. So I'm really proud about the work that we're doing here at the Institute for Addiction Science, where we have more than 50 faculty here at the University of Southern California who are members that cut across six schools. And it's really the first of its kind, where we're trying to unify the field of addiction science to really make some progress. And there's no better time than now to do that. So with that, I want to thank you once again for coming and spending your night here. And I would like to introduce our next speaker. So we're very fortunate to have Anthony Rodriguez. He's an outreach coordinator and trainer of the Santa Barbara Response Network. He's a three-time suicide survivor and is doing a lot just up the road in Santa Barbara to really help that community. And I think what he's doing up there would be a great model for what people should be doing in other communities. So let's welcome Anthony Rodriguez.
First and foremost, I want to say thank you for allowing me to be here and be the voice for those that are no longer here, and also be the voice for the families that are left behind. Never in my life did I ever think that I would be standing in front of you. As a three-time suicide attempt survivor, I was told that I wasn't worth it, ignored when I was hurt, and just basically thrown out. I wasn't expected to survive after 16 years old of how much trouble I was in. But nobody realized or knew what was going on. I was also, or am also, a sexual abuse survivor. I used to be a drug addict, alcohol. A mental health condition is real. And if you're currently struggling, I want you to know you're not alone. The change that I would like to see, and the reasons why I decided to speak, is because having support is very, very important. Somebody to listen to you is really important. This past week has been a very, very difficult week for myself and my wife. I had my aunt in the hospital. Same night, my mom ended up in the hospital, which she has Alzheimer's. And nobody listens because she doesn't know what she's talking about. I'm a couple of hundred miles away, trying to figure things out. I just got a new job. And then on Wednesday, I find out that my goddaughter passed away from cancer. But not only that, I also assisted during the Thomas Fire and the 1-9 debris flow in Santa Barbara, which I lost a student who was 10 years old. And then yesterday was my father-in-law's 1-year anniversary of his death. And today I was talking about it, and then I realized, how come I didn't think about taking my life this time? Why? Because thankfully, I have a job, which is a food bank of Santa Barbara County, allowed me to have my time with my family and said that was important. I remember I used to feel completely lost, not wanting to ask for a day off because everybody was going to say that I couldn't handle things. Well, it's not even like that. Sometimes we just need time for ourselves, time to breathe. Everybody deserves the time to breathe and not be judged. There's a lot of stigma with what we go through. All the time, no matter if somebody says, no, you don't. Yeah, we do. And the work that I do now, which nobody expected, I also was jumped into a gang at the age of 12, just so you know. I was left for dead, shot, stabbed. But things change, and people can change when you have the right support. So that's why I think it's important that I stand up here and be the voice for those that feel that they can't. And I'm proof that if you give somebody that just some time, we can make it through. It's not our fault that we have a mental health condition, just like everybody talks about diabetes. Well, if you have diabetes and you don't get your insulin, then what happens? You could die. Well, same thing with the mental health condition. That's what it is. And we shouldn't be embarrassed about it. There's nothing to be embarrassed about. I can't even believe I'm standing again in front of you. But I'm really hoping that business owners and people that can actually make a difference in our community really pay attention to the time and the employees that you guys do have. Give them a time, don't judge. And I hope that they can make a change and maybe have a mental health day, but maybe not even call it that so people don't have that stigma or worrying about they're gonna lose their job. Maybe just call it time to breathe, a day to breathe, because we all deserve it. And again, I really hope that somebody will make a difference and listen to others, because you know what, you're all worth it. And thank you for listening. I appreciate it.
Anthony, thank you for sharing your story and for the great work you do. So why don't we take just another moment and give another round of applause. Next, we have a special guest. Kiana Lede is a singer, songwriter, and actress. She starred in MTV's Scream and Netflix All About the Washingtons. As her career rose, she turned to her first love, music, following bouts of anxiety and depression. She felt power in sharing her vulnerability and strength through song and released her critically acclaimed debut album, Myself, last year. Kiana is here today to share her story and perform her song, Heavy. Please join me in welcoming Kiana Lede.
Hey. Hi, I'm Kiana. This is Carrie. It's been like a couple months since I've done this, so you gotta give me a little break, okay? So I'm gonna perform this song, Heavy, for you guys. Heavy's a song that I wrote when I was going through one of the most deepest depressions I've ever been through in my entire life. Anxiety, depression, addiction, all these things run really heavily in my family on both sides. So, I've been through it and lived through it my entire life, but this moment in particular was like unbearable for me. Luckily, I had the funds and the resources that I needed to be able to take the steps I needed to crawl out of my depression. But I know that's not always the case. My family is one that, knows struggle. So I've seen firsthand what it looks like when people don't have the correct and right access to healthcare to be able to take the steps that they need to get through, you know, mental illness and addiction. I try to do my part by normalizing the conversation and, you know, talking about my own personal struggles with anxiety and depression and writing music about it, because we know that music heals people and music has healed me. So I'm really honored to be here to contribute my small part in having this conversation about what the future of mental illness and mental health and addiction recovery looks like in this country. So thank you for letting me share and for having me. All right, we're gonna get rolling.
I don't got my priorities straight. Don't know who I'm gonna be today. I'm no victim, but I deal with shit on the daily. Something pulling, I can't get away. Never living outside of my head. I don't like showing weakness, so I always fake it. Maybe someday I will gain composure. Maybe when I'm older. I'm scared. Cause something feels like it's weighing me down. It takes control, turns my faith into doubt. And even when it's overcome, I'm on my feet, then I pull out the ground. So heavy. Just can't take it if it ain't you who love me when I'm naked. Fuck all my problems, wish I could solve them. Don't feel that wavy. I can't get up in the morning, it's too hot if I even try it. You ain't here to tell me turn my anxiety into excitement. Maybe one day I will gain composure. Maybe when I'm older. I'm scared. Cause something feels like it's weighing me down. It takes control, turns my faith into doubt. Hey, yeah. And even when it's all working out. Da-da-da-da. I'm on my feet and I pull out the ground. I wanna be like someone help me just feel alive. Is there a potion you got I could take? I wanna be like, feel like nothing's right. You got the answers, I swear that I listen. I'm ready now, yeah. Cause something feels like it's weighing me down. It takes control, turns my faith into doubt, yeah. And even when it's all working out, I'm on my feet, then I pull out the ground, so heavy.
Thank you so much.
Please join me in thanking Kiana for such a beautiful song and for sharing herself and her story with us today. Shifting back to USC, we now welcome Sophie Pine. Sophie is a USC alumnus and a person living in long-term recovery. She is the National Director of University Relations for The Haven at College, an inclusive community created to help students struggling with mental health and substance use have successful and safe college experiences. The Haven is the leading national provider of on-campus treatment and recovery support programs based at premier universities across the U.S. The Haven's continuum of care includes IOP treatment, peer-led recovery residences, and harm reduction programs for students who are beginning to address their substance use. Please join me in welcoming Sophie Pine.
Good evening, everyone. I am so grateful to be here and so grateful to all of you for being here. My name is Sophie, and I am a person in long-term recovery. That means I have not had a drink or used a drug since April 26, 2014. Thank you. I was 12 years old when I was introduced to my first drink from peers in school, and that was pretty much the beginning of a downward spiral for me into full-blown addiction throughout high school and at three different universities. I transferred to USC as a junior from South Africa, and while I was struggling with my disease, I did not know who to turn to or where to turn to when I needed help. As a student, there are already so many pressures that we have to navigate. Being away from home, making new friends, academic goals, navigating the social scene. Now add trying to navigate life while struggling with a mental health or substance use disorder. Nobody knew I was struggling here. It was easy to fly under the university radar as I somehow still was able to maintain my grades and show up for the bare minimum. Yet I was so isolated, I felt like giving up. And even though there were resources here available to me, my own denial, shame, and the stigma I experienced prevented me from reaching out. When I left USC to seek treatment as advised, coming back and eventually graduating seemed impossible. I found myself doubting whether I could be in recovery and actually succeed in school. I wouldn't have believed you if you told me there were other USC students here on campus who had been diagnosed with a substance use disorder, now living in recovery and actually having fun. But I was wrong. Fortunately for me, USC had recognized the importance of providing recovery support services for students on campus, and they developed a solution in collaboration with The Haven at College. I thank USC for being one of the first universities in the country to really serve students in this way. Transitioning back to USC was not easy. I faced many consequences as a result of my addiction. However, I had the power of a community to support me in overcoming these obstacles, a community of like-minded students who were just like me. The Haven gave me that community and gave me my life back, and I am forever grateful to them. They showed me that I did not have to choose between my recovery and my education. They empowered me to have both. I spent my senior year living at the Haven's recovery residence with 20 other students here at USC that were on the same journey as me. Some of them are still my best friends today, and we actually had the privilege of hosting Patrick Kennedy there today and had a little mini reunion, which was awesome. We were all working on our recovery while also engaged in our classes, student orgs, Greek life, athletics, you name it. I finally felt part of a community, part of USC, and I had finally found my passion again. Since finding recovery, I have graduated from USC twice and now have the privilege of sharing my story with other students and working with The Haven at College and other university administrators across the country to provide a comprehensive solution to substance use and mental health issues on campuses. I am so grateful that I had people here that understood my disease and could support my well-being and recovery, because without them, I may not be here. and we have already lost too many to this disease. We talk a lot about the pain of addiction, but there are actually 23 million Americans living in recovery today, right here in the US. And we want to reach as many students as possible, including supporters of recovery, and let students know that they can be sober and have a fulfilling life without drugs and alcohol. Every campus needs accessible resources like the Haven at College or some form of a collegiate recovery program so that we can begin to destigmatize addiction and mental health on campuses so that we don't have to lose another student, and so that a student who says, I'm in recovery and I'm in college, is not looked at having three heads. We need to bring recovery stories out of the shadows so that we can offer hope, so they can get help and recover too. I have the power of my own story, and you've heard some other stories tonight, and you may have a story to share too. We want people to know who we are, and we invite you to experience this journey with us. So thank you all for being here, and thank you all for supporting us.
Thank you, Sophie, for sharing your story and for the wonderful work you do at The Haven. And I'm going to go off script a little bit here. You know, you saw a movie about LAC-USC and how intense the struggles can be. And we live that environment every day. But today I had a chance to go over and see The Haven and listen to those stories, and I was blown away. I mean, truly blown away by the work that's being done there. So, if you haven't learned about what they're doing, go learn. And if you haven't figured out how to support places like that, that's what we're here to do tonight, and that's a great place to think about supporting. Now I'll go back on script. So now last but not least, I would like to introduce our final panel of the evening. This advocacy panel will provide best practices and tips for becoming a mental health and addiction advocate. Whether you're a student or a professional, whether you have lived experience or not, we all have an important role in transforming our systems to better meet the needs of people with mental health and substance use challenges. I invite Ryan Hampton to join me on stage to introduce the panelists. Ryan is the organizing director at the Recovery Advocacy Project, a network of people and organizations across the country advocating for addiction recovery policies, and founder of the Voices Project, a Mental Health for Us coalition leader. Welcome, Ryan.
There we go. My microphone's upside down. Thanks so much for having us tonight. It's always important when I come to convenings like this that I also self-identify. My name is Ryan Hampton. As you heard, I'm the organizing director for the Recovery Advocacy Project. I'm an author, I'm an advocate, I'm a dog lover, I'm a voter, I'm a taxpayer, but probably what's most important to me is I'm a person in long-term recovery from a substance use disorder, which means I haven't felt it necessary to have a drink or a drug or any other mind-altering substance since February 2nd, 2015. And tonight I learned something new, which is I share a recovery birthday month with Patrick Kennedy, which is pretty cool. Before we get started and I have the opportunity to introduce our amazing panel tonight, I just want to say how important, you know, this moment in time is for all of us. We're about 10 months away, a little bit shy of 10 months, from what will be the most important election I know of my lifetime and of your lifetime as well. You know, in 2016 and in 2018, right when I, in the beginning of my recovery, we heard a lot of promises around the addiction and the mental health crisis. We heard a lot of politicians and campaign ads, and I'm not going to get too political this evening, about ending this and how this was a priority. And I know we've heard some numbers tonight, and I know a lot of us read the newspaper and we turn on the news and we hear the numbers and the data and we see the charts, but I don't need to look at that to know that things actually are not getting any better. In fact, in my opinion, as an advocate, things are getting significantly worse. You know, there are waiting lists that you could roll out here from this stage that would reach all the way to San Diego of people who need help who can't access it. I buried two friends right before the holiday break who were in need of care and could not access it. So that's why convenings like this are so important. That's why what we hear tonight, what we learn tonight, and especially what we learn from this panel on advocacy, it is important that we go out into our communities, that we tell our stories, but we also tell our stories for impact, that we engage our policymakers on a local level, on a national level. We don't just have an election for president coming up in Congress and the Senate. We have elections for city council members, county commissioners, legislators, governors in many states, and they have a huge part to play in curbing this crisis. So with that being said, I'd like to introduce our amazing panel this evening. We have three awesome advocates. Ross Szabo is a social innovator who pioneered the youth mental health movement. He is the wellness director at the Geffen Academy at UCLA, a school that is focused on changing the way mental health is taught to middle school and high school students. Ross is also an award-winning speaker, author, and CEO of the Human Power Project. Leanna Treitler is a very busy teen, I have learned, a college freshman when she's not on Instagram or Snapchatting or FaceTiming with her friends. She's diligently studying. She's playing soccer, giving a speech, debating her fellow class members, or traveling. Since writing books on substance misuse with her dad, Leanna has been a requested speaker at a number of organizations and works with her family to educate middle and high school kids about substance use disorder. And Christina Miller, PhD, is president and CEO of Mental Health America of Los Angeles, one of the nation's largest and most comprehensive mental health services, training, and advocacy organizations. A licensed psychologist with over 25 years of leadership experience in social service, behavioral health, and medical care settings, she's held positions at UCLA, Cedars-Sinai Medical Center, OPCC, and D.D. Hirsch Mental Health. The first question, and I'd like to hear from all three of you, and I guess we'll start with Chris, is, you know, what is your personal connection about this? What led you into advocacy?
Actually, what led me into this, I've been in a lot of different settings, inpatient, outpatient, community mental health. 10 years ago, I was working at UCLA, and since this is USC, I can say this. I woke up one morning, I had one of those cushy situations where the benefits were great, and if I'd stayed there more years, I would have a huge retirement pension. And I just had this feeling, I thought, I cannot grow old here. I feel like I need to get back to community mental health where I can have the greatest impact. I resigned and went to my prior job, which was another nonprofit, because I really wanted to be as close as I could to making a difference. Mm-hmm. That's what, in terms of advocacy, there's different types of advocacy,
yep.
All kinds of advocacy. But for me, a key part of it is developing innovative solutions, piloting them, and then sharing those with other providers so that we can get to the best point we can in terms of the care and the services we provide.
Ross?
It's pretty clear, yeah. You know, we're uniting when you let someone from UCLA on stage here, so I appreciate that. My journey, I think, was really just by asking what's missing and then trying to fill it. I attempted to take my own life when I was a senior in high school, and at the time, I wasn't on anyone's radar. I was president of my class and a varsity basketball player and doing everything with a huge college resume. And after I got out, I realized that people bullied me and made fun of me and called me names, and I started speaking about my experience with bipolar disorder when I was in high school. And then when I was in college, I asked, well, why were there no full school assemblies when I was in high school about mental health?
And so I created a nonprofit organization to create large-scale mental health assemblies. Then I ran the National Mental Health Awareness Campaign from 2002 to 2010, and that's when we created the first youth mental health speakers bureau in the country. So when I used to do this back in 2002, like I knew all of the other youth mental health speakers. There were four of us. Mm-hmm. We knew what was going on, and now there's like tens of thousands. It's grown immensely. In 2007, I wrote a book called Behind Happy Faces, and then in 2010, I burned out. So I did what anyone does when they're exhausted. I joined the Peace Corps. I was like, oh man, I'm so tired. I came back from the Peace Corps in 2013, and I started a company to create mental health curriculum because I learned that it's one thing to advocate for mental health curriculum, but what we really need is a curriculum that teaches mental health the same way we learn about physical health from the youngest ages possible. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. So, started the company, curriculum was doing great, and then in 2016, UCLA was creating a school called Geffen Academy at UCLA, and they asked me if I could become a founding faculty member, what would I do? And I was like, well, if I got to create a school, students would learn about their mental health once a week in grades 6 through 12. It would be a required part of curriculum. It wouldn't be separate. It wouldn't be something you try. And we will do this to create a system. Thanks again. Appreciate it. But we would do this to create a system so that we can replicate it and change the education system in this country. And so that's how I got here. Thanks. Thank you.
Leanna?
So I'm particularly passionate about substance abuse and prevention, especially with kids and teens with addiction in their genes. I'm passionate about that because I am one. My dad is a recovering alcoholic, has been sober for going on 10 years. And after he came back from rehab, yeah, props for him. After he came back from rehab when I was 10 years old, he talked about what he wished his parents had taught him about the genetic link between addiction and other things like mental illness. So as a way of coping with his experience and my experience as his daughter, we started writing a book just about how I dealt with things and resources I used and turned to when I was recovering from my dad going through rehab. So we soon realized that the small family project was much more than just us. Pretty much everyone we knew had a mom or a sister or an aunt that was a recovering alcoholic too. So we decided to publish a book in 2016 called My Dad is an Alcoholic, What About You? And that sort of served as a preteen guide to navigating addiction and how you didn't have to follow in your addictive parents or guardians' footsteps. In 2018, we published a second book called Alcohol, Drugs, and You as a more general guide for teens and preteens first facing substances. And how they didn't have to do any sort of substance or drink at all, and how the best way to prevent addiction is to not start at all. Through these books, my family started the Red Rosebud Foundation, which raises money to distribute books to at-risk youth in juvenile halls, YMCAs, schools. And the mission of that is to advocate, educate, and eradicate. So I'm just passionate about removing the stigma for teens and preteens and talking about addiction, and then hopefully further eradicating the cause altogether.
Thank you.
So, Chris, a question for you. I mean, what can we do? How can advocates help shift the culture around the language when it comes to mental health?
I think, let me say something about the language, mm-hmm. first of all. We talk a lot about getting mental health services, mental health treatment, and in recent years, we've made great progress at medications that help people, a treatment that helps people. But the area that, where we need the most change is in our communities in terms of stigmas and attitudes. We can really do a lot to help someone get housed, to help them get stabilized with mental health conditions they have. But for a lot of people, the hardest point is moving into a community where they feel accepted. In my last job, we had someone who had been homeless, had a serious mental illness. He was on medication. We got him housed. But the staff couldn't reach him for follow-ups. And so I actually went out to his apartment that we had got for him. We found him lying in a ball on the floor. And it was really eye-opening to me. I said, you know, he had all those variables that researchers check off as success. He was on meds, he didn't bother the neighbors, his neighbors liked him, he had food in the refrigerator, but he said, I'm just really lonely. No one will talk to me. And so what our agency is really doing now, we've started an initiative to really affect the community. And we're, every week we're adding on a new nonprofit that's participating with us as a partner to do that. And what we're trying to do is look at what we need in our community, in our local community, to provide a safety net for people so that they get the community support they need. What I encourage all of you to do, no matter how much you know about mental health, is learn as much as you possibly can. If you don't, if you're not a student who's in the mental health field or you're not a mental health professional, take a mental health first aid class. Learn whatever you can, and then find local agencies and collaborations that you can join forces with. Because the advocacy works best when it's not just one person by themselves. It's the partnerships that really make it strong. And that's a key thing to
do. It's the community.
It's a community, mm-hmm. It's the whole community.
Yep. Liana, what, as a youth advocate, what's the hardest thing about being a youth advocate? And how do you deal with it?
I'd say definitely two things, more in the general sense. I think youth and teens have this idea that their voice won't mean anything, that if they speak up that no one will listen and no real change will be made. And I think especially coming to college my first year, seeing how many teens and college students are really pushing for what they believe in and how legislation and policymakers are listening really just goes to show how much teen voices can mean. So I feel like as a young advocate, and many advocates like myself are trying to break that barrier of teens feeling that their voices aren't being heard. I mean, we're having summits like this and things across my campus all the time where teens are just sharing their opinions and people are starting to listen. So I think that's the first. And in my specific area of addiction prevention, I think speaking up is a really big problem. I think a lot of teens and preteens feel like they can't speak about things just because it's out of the norm or people think they're weird. So I think just speaking up and not being afraid to share your story, because that's really what affects people and that's really what gets people listening. Just feeling like you can share your voice, because then everyone realizes they're not alone and then people will start to listen.
Yeah, I've found that when my advocacy story, people always ask, they say, well, how'd you become an advocate? Well, honest to truth, I didn't wake up on February 3rd, 2015, the day after I, you know, got sober and said, I want to be an advocate. Right? It was actually the result of a lot of things which started with me telling my story. Mm-hmm. Once I told my story for the first time and I was able to shed all of that shame and weight that I had been carrying for so long, it set me down on this journey of what I like to call the journey of what's next. I wanted to know what was next. What was it that I could do for my community? Ross, do policymakers, do the decision makers actually care what we have to say? Do they pay attention to us? Do they listen to us? And if you could follow that up with kind of one example of advocacy in action from your own lived experience?
Sure. I think that local politics is one of the biggest places to make a difference.
Right. Yep.
When you get mental health courts in action and you get people advocating for them, I think it makes a huge difference. I think in national politics, we haven't gotten to a place mm-hmm. where they care. I think it was amazing to pass parity in 2006. I think having parity included in the Affordable Care Act was great, but no one's funded it. So
right.
it's passed in name only. I think the most important thing anyone here
can do. Or enforced it.
What's that? Yeah.
Or enforced it.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the most important thing anyone here can do is really find ways to advocate in your own words. To go back to the language message, our language around mental health sucks. For a lot of reasons. One, we did a study at UCLA where we asked 1,200 college students if they could define mental health, and less than 25% could. Everyone still thinks mental health is a person who has a problem, and it's not. Mental health is how you address challenges in your lives. It's not having depression or anxiety disorders or stress or lack of sleep. It's how you address those things. And when we think about the mental health spectrum, which is what a lot of people advocate around, the current mental health spectrum that most people use is on one side you have people who are sane, and on the other side you have people with severe mental health disorders. And this spectrum is not only wrong, it's broken. Because you can have a severe mental health disorder and be sane at the same time. Mm-hmm. And if you're on two places on the spectrum at the same time, the spectrum doesn't work. If you think about physical health, we don't do that. We don't promote that you're either healthy or you're not. We don't teach people that you should only eat healthily when you get diabetes. We promote the concept that physical health is a broader spectrum about balance. We need to do the same thing with mental health. We need to run from being able to balance to not being able to balance and putting help in the middle, because that's where it is for our physical health. So when we advocate, we have to stop saying mental health is like physical health and start educating about it and start actually teaching people what that means. Because on a college campus like this today, you have a student who has stress telling a student who has an anxiety disorder to just calm down. They're not the same things. Right. You have students who went through a breakup telling somebody who has clinical depression to just be happy, and they're not the same things. So the most important thing we can do policy-wise, advocate as an advocate, is actually teach what we want to see, and then they'll listen.
Yeah, you brought up the point of local, right? Local is so important, and I just want to share a really quick story, because every chance I have, I always try to tell Tyler's story. You know, Tyler was a very, very good friend of mine, one of the first people that I worked with in my early days in recovery, in my recovery room. We kind of had this like mentor-mentee relationship in our recovery program. And in October of 2017, early fall 2017, Tyler called me, and he was staying at a recovery residence, which is also known for some people as a sober living, in Pasadena, which isn't too far from here. One of these larger, you know, more expensive, was supposed to be a supportive living environment. 80% of people who lived in this house had opioid use disorder. Tyler's story was he was in recovery from intravenous heroin. He came home one day, he called me, he said, look, I'm using again, I need help, I don't know what to do. I said, well, Tyler, are they gonna let you stay at the house tonight? He said, yes, at least I have a roof over my head. I said, that's great, I'll be there tomorrow. You know, I'll pick you up. We're gonna go and see if we can find treatment. Tyler didn't have insurance. Tyler didn't have any cash pay. We literally had to go and scrape together whatever we could and find some public resources for him the next morning. The sad thing was is that Tyler didn't make it to the next morning. He died that night. He died after that phone call. I learned of it the next day by scrolling through Facebook, right? Finding out that my friend died at this sober living, and I was angry and I was sad, but I wanted to know what happened. So I went to this sober living and asked what happened. And they, the story I got was the sober living manager had come home that evening, went to check on him the next morning. They asked him to sleep in the living room. When they checked on him at 6 a.m. in the morning, Tyler was still alive, but he was having a really hard time breathing. He was blue in the face. He was clearly in the middle of an overdose, except no one at the house had naloxone. No one was trained on how to respond to an overdose. This was a home that his family was paying upwards of $1,000 a month to, for it to be a safe environment for him and his peers. And all that was angering, but what was more angering was that day when I went to go visit the house and ask what happened, and I found out there was no naloxone, which is the anti-overdose anecdote. The manager, the owner actually of the house, put her hand on my shoulder and she said, you know, I know you're upset, Ryan, but the sad story here is that Tyler just didn't want to get sober enough. He didn't want to find recovery enough. And instead of getting angry and yelling and screaming and, you know, taking it all out on this house, that week, myself and two friends of Tyler's, three people, right? Two of them who had never been engaged in policy or politics before. We went to our member of Congress, to her local district office, and we went to our state senator's office, and we demanded a meeting with them. We didn't know what to do, but we knew something was wrong. We knew that our friends were dying in our own backyard, and there was not access to services. And our policymakers were shocked to hear this. In fact, many of them had never even heard of a recovery residence. So they worked with us, these three individuals, to craft a piece of federal legislation, which was H.R. 4684, the Ensuring Access to Quality Sober Living Act. Supportive housing for people in recovery from substance use disorder has been around for a long time, but there's never been standards to actually protect them as consumers, standards that would require things like naloxone on hand, financial transparency, other things like that. We helped author a bill like that in California that mirrored it. Those three advocates, and myself included, we testified in front of the US Congress. We worked with members in the Senate and the House The bill was passed unanimously in the House. It was known on Capitol Hill as Tyler's Law. It was passed in the Senate with one vote against it, and it was signed into law by President Trump last October. That is the law of the land. That was done by three young advocates who were earlier in their recovery, who didn't know we were doing advocacy at the time. We didn't really call it advocacy. We just called it, we're fed up of watching our friends die, right? And we decided to take it to the next level and to our legislators. That's something that each and every one of you can do, which is why it's so important when you leave here today that you take what you learn into your community and you don't just leave it here, that you take it and you do something with it and educate someone else, hopefully a policymaker. And that's a great segue for us to kind of go into our last question. You know, we are going into an election season, a very heated election season. What is it that folks can do who are here in the audience and folks who are watching? What is it they can do to make an impact on mental health and addiction issues? And I'll start with Chris.
One of the things I would urge people to do is to realize you don't have to go off to a lawmaker to advocate. You can start in your own community with your friends, with your family, raising the conversation about mental health, what it is, using language that's very inclusive about where we want to get to make a difference. And then I really urge you to research what's going on and what's most important to you and where you can join forces at a higher level, at a broader level. But even changing minds if you're a student in your dorm with people who don't understand this, that's advocacy. Mm-hmm. If you help your roommate understand mental illness and mental health better, that's advocacy. So it's important to look at what you have access to.
Yep.
I think some of the biggest changes on college campuses have come from students. The California state law mandating that every student ID has access to the counseling center phone number on the back came from students. Mm-hmm. When Patrick Kennedy was talking about the Gordon Smith law, that came from a college student dying by suicide. This fall, we watched Holinsky's Hope go through every SEC stadium and have hundreds of thousands of people hold up the number 3 for a college student quarterback who died by suicide. If you're sitting in this audience tonight and you're a college student, know that you have a voice and that you have power. All of our campuses are seeing way too many losses of young lives, of people who die way too soon. And if you've been through that loss and you've been through that pain and you're sitting here tonight, know that what you say to your administration, how you organize, whether it's Active Minds or NAMI on campus or the group that was mentioned earlier, whatever you're doing can make a difference. So in this election season and beyond it, speak out for the community that you are a part of. Speak out for your friends and people in your dorms and people that you live with that you know don't have a voice, that are too embarrassed or too ashamed or just don't know how to work on this. We can't stop this problem without your voice, without your story, without your message. And the more that you organize together in your own communities on campuses, the more changes that you can see, because you are all investing a lot in this place and in colleges around the country to not have access to the help and the care and to have so much loneliness and pain that you have. So please speak up.
I'd speak first to the parents. Don't be afraid to educate your kids. I feel like the biggest and first step in removing the stigma and talking about mental health and addiction is talking to your kids about it, even from a young age. I think my parents, one of the best things they did for me was start talking to me about addiction when I was young, teaching me about the dangers, telling me the horror stories so I knew what kind of a world I was living in. And I'd second speak to the students in the room. Don't be afraid to share your story, because you don't know who feels alone, who feels like they don't have someone to talk to. And you may be the reason why they feel like they can speak up and get help.
Thank you all so much for joining us here this evening. And let's thank our awesome panel. And thank you all so much for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Thank you to our wonderful panel. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
So lastly, I'd like to thank our event partner, the Institute for Addiction Science, our event sponsors, Kaiser Permanente and Sutter Health, our champion sponsors, the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, Kaiser Permanente, the Kennedy Forum, the National Council for Behavioral Health, and of course, a huge thank you to the entire Mental Health for Us Coalition for making this event possible. If you haven't done so already, please text BRAIN to 444-999 or visit mentalhealthforus.net/support to join our movement. We show what we care about through our actions. Tonight, we hope you were inspired to take action. And unite to show the world that access to mental health and addiction care matters to us. Thank you and good night.